What I'm going to be talking about today is on, is the title is The Heart of Heart Disease, and really it's a very relevant matter, and it is a matter that has affected many people for a long time. And today we have quite a number of technologies that will be able to help us in coping with heart disease, but there's a lot more that I think is really important for us to know about the heart, and I hope that the information that I will present will help you to understand more about your organ and to appreciate also about your organ, and will do things, you will choose to do things to help that your organ will stay alive and healthy. So what do you think are the top causes of deaths?
Cancer.
Cancer. We hear a lot of cancer. Someone said heart disease.
Diabetes.
What else? Suicide. Suicide. So I have here a chart, and this is like the American, taken from statistics over in America, over in 2015, I believe. And there's a whole range of different types of deaths, and you can't see it from the top there. Injuries, violence, heart disease, liver, pancreas, cancer, poisonings, I'm going from left to right here. Kidney disease, influenza, suicide, hypertension, colon cancer, auto accidents, diabetes, breast cancer, and then we get to the top five. So the top five is lung disease, Alzheimer's, stroke, lung cancer, and coronary heart disease. In England, and maybe that's only in England because perhaps maybe it's a very safe place, but heart disease is the number of those who have died from heart disease way supersedes those who have died from war. And that's a serious thing if you actually consider it. Maybe that's only in England. Maybe if it was somewhere else, it would be different. But it tells us that not only that in America it's a problem, in England it's a problem, but also in Australia it's a huge problem. The leading causes of death in Australia in 2014, according to the Bureau of Statistics in Australia here. If you go from, so the first, second, third, fourth, fifth columns are the top one to the fifth, and then it goes down to the range of ages from age of 1 to age of 95. And as you can see, from age 45 onwards, the top number one cause of death is what? Coronary heart disease. And it goes to lung cancer, and it goes to breast and cerebrovascular disease, Alzheimer's disease, and then younger than that would be suicide. Now this tells us something, that there is a need for people to understand more about the enormity of what happens when your heart fails, or when your heart is not healthy. And if you compare between male and female, again, ischemic heart disease, which is pretty much coronary heart disease, is the top. And then under that is dementia, and then cerebrovascular, and then cancer of bronchus and lung and trachea. And then on the fifth one is chronic low risk respiratory disease. And this is only from the data in 2014. One in seven deaths for male and one in eight deaths for female. We need to understand more about how we can appreciate our organ, our one and only organ. This is just some stats, facts about heart. So it beats about 70 times per minute. And if you think about it, that's only for per minute. When does your heart actually rest?
Never.
Never, yeah. If it rests, there's a problem. There's a big problem. That's when the ear goes into shutdown and you will go into shutdown as well. So 70 times per minute beats, or otherwise 100,000 per day, or otherwise more than 36 million per year, or more than 3 billion times in a lifetime, just in an average lifetime of about 70 to 80 years of age. That's a lot of beating, and that's a lot of work that your small organ, which is the size of a fist, is actually doing. It pumps 1 million barrels of blood in a lifetime. If you think of barrels, you know, the barrels that are this big, 1 million barrels of blood. That's a lot of blood. And flows through 60,000 miles of arteries, veins, capillaries to carry oxygenated blood from the heart. It carries oxygenated blood to all your cells, all over your body. And then after it transports nutrients to the cells, there's this exchange between the blood to the cell membrane. And then it carries the blood, the red blood cells, and goes all the way back again into the heart, to the lung, to get reoxygenated. And then it goes back again into the heart, carrying the oxygenated blood. Then it gets pumped by the heart into all the other parts of the body. It's a serious pump. And in fact, if you stuff this up, it's your plumbing. Usually, if we have something wrong with our tap or whatever it is in our home, with the dishwasher or the washing machine, and something goes wrong, we'll call our plumber and we're thinking, oh, I should have been a plumber because it's so expensive. And I tell you what, this plumber, the plumbing people who are actually doing this are even more expensive. And so this is why you need to really look after your heart. It pumps 70 to 75 trillion cells in the body. Now, heart is the first organ to form in an embryo. So this is a 10 and a half days of mass embryo. Very, very small. And the one that's in the red in the center there, that's basically the staining of the heart. And the heart, initially when the cells are forming, they can actually communicate and transfer nutrients to one another when it first formed. And then as it divides, it's difficult for the nutrients to actually get transported from one end to another. And that's why it's very intricately designed that the heart gets formed in order to transport all the blood to the other parts of the cells that have been newly formed. And so a heart is made up of four chambers. And I've got here for you just a bit of a demo of a real heart. So I went, I asked my So I asked my previous boss and I said, oh, can I actually borrow some heart from mice, and also we've got some samples from very, very sick patients from one of our family cohort. And so she was thinking, oh, that would be great for presentation, but, you know, it's against ethics for us to actually do this. So anyway, so I decided to actually go and grab some heart from the local butcher. So this is from sheep, and I don't know if you can see it. Oh yeah, you can. Okay, great, good. So this is a whole heart. It's pretty much really the size of your fist. Yeah, kind of the size of my fist. Maybe, yeah, slightly bigger. And this is what you call as the apex, and that's the base. This is, when you're looking at it, you're looking down into the chest of the animal. And so this is the left side and this is the right side. You've got here the left ventricle and the right ventricle, the left atrium and the right atrium. So what happens is that when the blood comes from the lung, it goes into the pulmonary vein and it goes into the left atrium and it travels into the right, into the left ventricle and then out into the aorta, and it gets pumped. So that should be the aorta there. You can see? So it's very big. You can see, right? And because the left ventricle is very important, because that's when you need the most enormous amount of pressure to be able to pump blood to all the cells. And the left ventricle is usually a little bit bigger than the right ventricle. So when I cut it in half, I have here okay, it's really nice and red on the screen. It's kind of like a bit brown. I put it in like saline solution last night, yesterday afternoon. Anyway, so this is the right, this is the left ventricle here, and that's the right. So you've got here the left atrium, blood comes from the lung into the left atrium, and it travels in to the left ventricle, and the left ventricle pumps it out into the aortic valve there, and then goes out, and it comes again through the superior vena cava or the inferior vena cava into the right atrium, and it goes into the right ventricle, and it gets pumped out into the pulmonary artery, and then into the lung. So this is basically the four chambers of the heart: the upper left, the two upper left, and the two lower. The two upper and the two lower, and with all the tendons as well. Now, the amazing thing about heart is that can you go to the next slide. It has an independent, it's pretty much like an independent electric box, really. It's so fascinating. When I first took out a heart from an animal, I was so, I learned it, but until when I saw it, I got really excited because it was still beating in my hand. And then I put it into a specific solution. I hang it up onto a solution with a catheter, and we would basically perfuse through this Krebs solution. And the solution would allow, because of the amount of potassium and as well as sodium in it, it would actually allow for the heart to continue to pump. And that allows us to be able to then isolate the cells eventually. And so the heart itself has this automatic rhythmicity because there is pacemaker cells that are situated in the upper right spot in the diagram there. You can see SA node, the sinoatrial node. That's pretty much the pacemaker cells, and it travels down, so somewhere here, and it travels down, and it basically innervates this electrical impulse through the myocardium, through the muscle fibers, really. And it goes to the atrioventricular node, and it travels down to the Purkinje fibers. So when the electrical impulse are sent, the contraction then gets, it tells the heart to contract or relax. And then it travels again down to the ventricle, it tells the heart to contract and relax. Now, the cells are very, very small, and yet the whole heart pumps based on these very tiny cells, the cardiac pacemaker cells. And that's why you have the ECG reading, and which you may have seen in hospitals or movies as well, in the ICU. So anyway, so this is a little bit more of an insight about what the heart looks like. If you go to the next one, if you can press the movie there, you'll see also there is the heart beating, and that's pretty much really what I've seen when we're actually hanging the heart from, that's a big heart, I think that's probably a pig heart. But yeah, we tend to utilize different animals, unless you know of someone who wants to give the heart away while they're still alive. I don't think so. So this is why we have to use animals to help us to understand more about how the heart works. Okay, I found my clicker. So what are the different cardiovascular diseases that are pretty much common, really, on the sort of maybe top five? Before I go forward, so the heart is made up of cardiomyocytes, or heart muscles, heart muscle cells. So these are actually muscles, but they're different to our skeletal muscles, which is basically on our hands and as well as our limbs, legs, and they're also different to the smooth muscle that helps some of our organs to contract. Heart cells are called cardiomyocytes, and this is some of the pictures that we've had before in the lab, and that's pretty much really just what the heart cell looks like, just that green thing, and it's been stained with different proteins, that's why it has different colors. And if you can see on the left picture at the bottom there, on the green one, you can see that these heart cells are all connected to one another. Now, if you have one heart cell on its own, it can't actually contract or relax on its own. It needs to actually have a community of different cells to be able to contract. And particularly if you have the cardiac pacemaker cells that are nearby. So when you have these cells together and you have the cardiac pacemaker cells nearby, it actually then is able to then boom, 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 boom. And amazingly, when I actually laid down some of these mouse embryonic heart cells and I plated them, allowed them to grow, and then they start to form their individual before, and then when they started to grow, they started to stick to one another, and they form this thin sheet on the plate, then you start to see, you can't see it on the plate when you see it just with your eyes, but when you put it on the microscope, it's so amazing because it feels like as if that plate is going to shake because it's just, the whole thing is just boom, 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 boom. It's just, yeah, I just find it fascinating, sorry. Maybe you won't find it fascinating, but I found it fascinating when I look down the microscope and then this whole thing is just like lifting up and down on its own. And so that's basically really how our heart cells work. And so when there is a problem with the muscle itself, this is when you actually get cardiomyopathy. Cardiomyopathy means cardiac is heart, myo is muscle, pathy is from pathology, so there is a problem, there's a pathology within the heart muscle itself. There are three common types of cardiomyopathies. So there's dilated cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, or otherwise restrictive cardiomyopathy. Dilated cardiomyopathy is when you have a problem with the heart, where the heart muscle becomes, all of the muscles really weaken. And they weaken and they become very flabby. And they have no strength to be able to pump the blood out from the heart. And so when it doesn't have the strength to be able to pump the blood, usually when the heart is beating, in the left ventricle, which where I showed you before, it would be pumping like this. But within a dilated cardiomyopathy left ventricle, it would be pumping like this. So as you can imagine, when the blood comes into the ventricle, it actually, not all of them gets pumped out from the heart. And so it remains within the ventricle and it forms blood clots. And it forms and it starts to actually stiffen. And eventually when the heart becomes weaker and weaker and weaker, it then, more blood then gets pulled. That's where it gets extended. And that's what's usually called the big fat heart or the baggy heart syndrome. And it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and it can't do it anymore and it would just stop. Those who have problem with dilated cardiomyopathy or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, anyway, cardiomyopathies, they usually are on the list for the heart transplant. So with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, this is when the heart muscle becomes thicker. So in dilated, it becomes thinner, but within hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the heart muscle becomes thicker. Not necessarily that the heart is bigger, just a thicker right ventricle and left ventricle. And there are actually a number of athletes who suffer from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and while they're playing baseball or soccer or whatever it is, they suddenly die on the field. And commonly this is from hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Or restrictive cardiomyopathy is when there is a restriction. There is a stiffening of the heart muscle itself, and the heart muscle is not able to pump. And this is common in a lot of the elderly. So how come we have cardiomyopathies? Well, particularly with cardiac cardiomyopathy, 50% of it is usually from secondary cause of lifestyle. Something wrong with the lifestyle. And that then becomes, there is some sort of plaque formation within the blood vessels, and then there is a restriction for the blood to flow into particular areas within the heart. And then you will find yourself getting heart attacks, and then there is all sorts of different reasons. And so with dilated cardiomyopathy, 50% of it is because of a secondary cause. But the other 50%, there is no understanding why. And within a small subset of that other half, about 20% of them is actually due to genetic abnormalities. So it is actually quite sad. You can actually have a 20-year-old who is very fit and have to go onto the heart transplant list because of a genetic aberration. The other one that you may have heard of, AF, or atrial fibrillation, is when there is a rhythm problem within the heart. So the heart, as I mentioned before, has this automatic rhythmicity because of the electrical impulse that's traveling from the sinoatrial node down to the AV node and then into the Purkinje fibers to the rest of the ventricle. When there is atrial fibrillation, there is abnormality within the rhythm. These electrical signals, instead of it traveling down, they actually form their own little circuits. And so the heart is like going crazy. You're like, oh, what are we doing? It's like, oh, there's another impulse here, and then there's another impulse here, and there's another impulse here. And so the heart just starts to go crazy. And a lot of older people actually get AF, atrial fibrillation. That's because of different causes. Again, blockage within the heart vessels. The vessels that are within our hearts are very important to look after. And when you have disruption of the blood flow, it causes parts of the heart to then die. And you've got these micro parts within the heart that has no function at all. There is necrosis of the or cell death of the heart muscle. And then the electrical impulse cannot actually get through. And so it has to find another pathway for it to then travel. Another disease called coronary heart disease, as you may have heard of, CHD, or coronary artery disease. So this is when the front part of the heart, as you can see, there's the two main arteries there, the left and the right. And on the left, both on the left or the right, where there is the normal artery, you can see there is very clean, but the blocked artery is when there is a deposition of fats, really. And when you have a blockage within the artery, as you can just already imagine, that there will be a inadequate blood to that particular heart portion, and then you will get chest pain, and then that will develop into a heart attack. Usually by the time you actually get chest pain, you should just go straight to the hospital and get yourself checked. Coronary artery disease is because of atherosclerosis. And atherosclerosis, as I mentioned before, same as what I mentioned, that there is a blockage within the vessel itself. And this is just an explanation of a little bit of... Oh, I can just do that. Yeah. So with atherosclerosis, when there is a blockage, there's usually also a formation of these lump. And this lump will then break off, and they actually can block other parts of the arteries, or within our bodies, or even within our brain. Now, our blood vessels have been so intricately designed because it's got the outer layer and the inner layer, and the inner layer, where the squamous cells are, when the blood cells are going through and then the white blood cells are there, the green, those green balls are like the lipid particles. They're called the LDL protein. They carry this cholesterol and they stick onto the squamous cells, and then they get through and squeeze it into the epithelial cells, and they try to then form some sort of colony there, and then the macrophages would then start to attack it and try to engulf it. They become like foam cells, they rupture, and they've got this flat deposition, and the flat deposition forms into a plaque, and the plaque then gets bigger and bigger, and this is really all because of what we eat. This is all because of what we eat. And how we actually, whether or not we don't, maybe we don't move around as much. And eventually these epithelial, plaque, they start to get bigger and bigger, and they would rupture. And then of course all the platelets and all the fibrin, they start to get together and they start to form like some sort of plaster to cover it. And of course the plaster gets bigger and bigger and bigger to a point that the blood vessel, the blood cells cannot actually proceed through that particular artery or that particular vein. So this is where it really becomes so important. Our body is so ingeniously designed, and it tries to do all it can to prevent it from falling apart. But there is only a limit to what it can actually do as well. This is just a bit more of an explanation of what happens. And pretty much really, these white blood cells, they form their work and they try to do their best to clean up all the fats that they can. But when there is too much, because of what we eat, we continue to expose ourselves in the different kinds of food that is that brings about oxidative stress, that brings about inflammation, and so the body is not able to cope with it, and then it would burst. And then that particular thrombus formation there, because of this rupture from the fibrous cap, it actually then travels to various parts of the body. Now, you think, oh, well, atherosclerosis, ah, that's like old man's disease. I'm not going to get it when I'm young. But the fatty streak that is within your underneath the layer of the epithelial cells there, the squamous cells, these fatty streaks, they form in the first decade of life. Now, if you're thinking, oh, you know, that's all right, I'll exercise it, that's fine, you know, I can eat whatever I want, when I get older, then I'll start to look after my health. Bum, bum. Because you already have them, probably. And I may already have them too. So these starts to form the first decade, and then it gets bigger in the third decade. And if you continue to have the same kind of lifestyle, then you'll have these, by the time you get to 40, 45, 50, you're already a dead man walking. Because those thrombus, they will block your artery. And if it blocks your heart, you have a heart attack coming up. And if it doesn't, if it comes off, then it will actually travel. And when it does travel, it travels to other parts of the vessels. It starts to swim around in your vessels, in your artery, gets traveled around, and then it gets to your brain. And then if you actually have these plaques even closer to your brain, you will have stroke. This is where it becomes cerebrovascular disease. Is also one of the top five. So I wanted to actually point out to you that it is absolutely important to make sure that your arteries are clear. They're like freeways. You hate traffic when you see it. When you're in it, so are your red blood cells. So you need to make sure that they're free flowing all the time. Causes of cardiovascular disease. I mentioned atherosclerosis, poor lifestyle because of lack of inactivity, obesity, stress, ongoing low level of inflammation that continues to build up, and these plaques, these blood vessel walls, they become more and more permeable to all these LDLs, The LDLs come from all your chips, all your burgers, all the packet of chips, the hot chips, the things that are fried. I love these things as well. I struggle with this as well. But I just want to make it clear to you that these are real and they will be an investment for your heart, right? And we have oxidative stress, exposure, ingestion of substances and behavior that produce free radicals, so alcohol, cigarette smoking, high level of unhealthy fats and refined sugars, high LDL cholesterol. If you have the high LDL cholesterol, they start to pick up all these excess fats and they carry it over to the liver, transport it, and it gets break down in the liver. But if you have low of the high HDL, sorry, I'm talking about the HDL. If you have low level of the HDL, which is the good protein, then it doesn't actually able to perform its work in order to clean up your blood vessels. But if so, usually you have low HDL and high LDL, and then you're in big trouble. So this is when you need to start changing your diets. So these are just, you know what it is. Everybody knows that you need to change your lifestyle in order to have a healthy working heart. Kidneys, how many are there?
Two.
Two. Eyes? Two. Ears? Two. Hands? Two. Heart? One. One. Smoking causes inflammation and oxidative stress. It causes biochemical damage. It promotes coronary heart disease. It causes stroke. If you have 4 cigarettes a day, it doubles or triples your chances of getting coronary artery disease. Basically, the plaques, the formation of it. It allows for your blood vessels to become more permeable for these LDLs to squeeze through into your intima. And if you are also exposing yourself, my screen is a bit too small, a bit too big, sorry. If you also are getting secondary smoking from people around you, it increases also your risk of developing coronary heart disease by 25 to 30%. That's a lot. 25 to 30% is a lot. So quit while you can, or encourage someone to quit while they can. Eating harmfully, more processed foods, foods of animal products, foods high that are in salts or in refined sugar. These also bring you to a position where you are investing in fatty streaks for your blood vessels. Increases level of trans and saturated fats, increases your oxidized LDL, increases obviously unnecessary weight gain, also blood pressure and plaque formation. Lack of physical activity. Actually, can everyone just stand up? I don't want everyone to be increasing their risk of developing colon cancer by 30% because you've been sitting for 30 minutes. Oh dear. Because you're listening to Christiana talking. You can sit down now. And usually what we do at work, and my current work now, is that we try to skip, or we try to do like some moving around, go to the toilet, go and grab your drink, do some like some squats, do some, you know, star jumps every 30 minutes or every 1 hour, because it's so important. You were made to actually move. We're not made to sit, by the way. Yeah, we're made to rest, of course. It's time to rest. It's time to sit down, but we're made to actually move. And so these days we have a lot of, we have quite a number of schools that promote they basically have the standing desks in order for kids to not only just sit down all day. You know, a lot of them sit down all day, and if they're not necessarily active kids, they will sit down through recess, they will sit down through lunchtime. So they want to actually encourage students to now stand up while they're studying. The top 5 deaths are actually preventable deaths. We have here a comparison of low-income, middle-income countries, and as well as high-income countries. The middle and high-income countries, the number one death is ischemic heart disease. The number one death for low-income countries is also a lifestyle one, which is a lower respiratory infection. So everyone is affected. because of lifestyle. If you're not getting heart disease, you might be getting Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is also a lifestyle disease. So I guess you can really choose which disease you want to get by the things that you do, by the things that you eat. But I'm sure that you don't want to put yourself in a position. I'm going to read it from my iPad because I can't read that. Okay. Biochemical damage is not going to be obvious until it causes structural or electrical damage. Just think about that for a moment. Biochemical damage is not going to be obvious until it causes structural or electrical damage. What we do in our body, what we put in, is that we basically put ourselves into a biochemical damage exposure. We can't see it with our eyes. We may not necessarily feel it, but our cells do. They go through these reactions and they start to try to understand why there are these strange things that are happening, and they try to compensate by using various different kinds of protein. They try to work as hard as they can in order for you to continue to live. Once the heart is damaged, it can't be completely repaired. That's sad. We have very good technology these days. You can even put a new heart into your body from an animal. But why would you want to give your heart away? Why can't you just keep your heart? And if you have it already damaged, we can actually do all sorts of things. There are stents, there are various ways for the heart to be able to be recuperated, but it will never be the same as before. But if you only have minor blood vessel damage, if you have minor blood vessel damage, there is actually a chance for you to be able to reverse that and prevent heart condition. So the choice, I guess, is up to you, what you want to do with your heart, what you want to do with your health. Now, you may have heard former President Bill Clinton. He had a heart condition. So that was in 2004. He had a blocked coronary artery. They rushed him to the hospital and they did quadruple bypass surgery. And then later on, 6 years later, he had to have his stents renewed again. And he had his heart fixed, but he decided that he had to make a change. He contacted and researched into various doctors who might be able to help him. And Dr. Dean Ornish was approached. He actually went through the China study. I should rephrase that. There's Colin Campbell and Thomas Campbell who actually ran the China study. And together with Caldwell Esselstyn, if I can say that his name right, these men with Dr. Dean Ornish, they were onto this game on preventing and reversing heart disease. So there are ways to do it, and it is actually not too late for some. For many, actually, it's not too late if you are serious about it. So Dr. Ornish challenged him to look into a vegan diet. And so Bill Clinton then decided he'll give it a go. He lost 30 pounds. And then he started campaigning against obesity in the US. But then later on, he decided to leave his vegan diet to become a paleo man. I'm not sure what the latest is with him. So the vegan society people are like, you shouldn't be getting into the paleo diet. But anyway, that's what he decided. But at least what he's trying to do, and I respect him for this, that he wanted to make changes. And he experienced benefits from making those changes. And if you or someone that you know are experiencing problems with it, encourage them that there is a way to make changes. And even if it seems already too late, you can still benefit by making the change. You can change the way that you shop. The things that you put in your shopping trolley. I took some of these pictures when I went shopping last time at this fruit market. And, replacing your animal products with plant-based products. plant-based products that are colorful. Not we eat too many yellow things. We need to eat more that are colorful. The dark purple ones, the red, the green. We have so many varieties here in Australia. I speak to a number of people who go through, who have lived in different countries, and they say that the food in Australia here are actually really good. So make use of the community that you're around right now, and be active. You need to walk around. You need to exercise 30 minutes every day. If you can't do it every day, 5 times a day. And if you can't do it, just at least 10 minutes a day, if possible. You know, this adds up. And not only just if you exercise in the morning and you go, tick, I've done my exercise, woo, I can just sit the whole day. No, that doesn't work either. That also, you're still within the risk of getting colon cancer by 30%. So, how much does your heart cost?
$1 billion.
Yeah, you really can't put a value, right? You really can't put a value in how much your heart cost. I would not want to sort of even think about how much it would be. Everyone is affected, though. And here we have our old Prime Minister here before, previous Prime Minister, and then we also consider the costs that are involved. If you don't have a lot of money, then you better start making investments on your heart health. And if you have a lot of money, don't waste it on the medicines, don't waste it on the pills, don't waste it on the surgeries. Do the best you can, and for some, it's unavoidable. For some, there is a heart condition, there is a mutation that's inherited within the family, and that can't be helped. But if you can actually prevent it yourself, then that would be even better. But if you can't, if there are many people who are within the heart transplant list, and they could actually prevent themselves from being on the heart transplant list, but you see, they're getting in the way of those who actually can't help themselves. There are people who are waiting to actually have a new heart. And every day is a time bomb for them. I bought the sheep heart for $2. One of them was for $2. So I paid for 3. I'm like, oh, I don't know how many I should get. And the guy was going, you know, I said, how much does it cost? And he said, well, $2? So how many do you want? So look, I'll just give you the 3. We're just going to throw it out anyway. When you go through surgery, your heart is also going to be thrown out. Or otherwise, it goes into a little bottle like that, goes into a lab, and we try to study it, and we try to look at it, and it just becomes a demonstration of how bad is our lifestyle. So I just want to plead to you today to ensure that you would live a healthy lifestyle. Make some changes in what you eat. Make some changes in how you would look after your body. In your sleeping time, I'm a problem with this one. In your also your activity times, when you actually would allow yourselves to make the time to walk, make the time to exercise, and to have vigorous exercise as well. Not just, you know, walking to the shop is your exercise. No, we want to have your heart rate going. Not just walking over there, down the road. I've done my exercise today. It's like, no, no, no. Your heart is too invaluable for you to do less than that. So I hope that you can benefit from this, and I hope that you can be encouraged and be re-motivated to be more healthy. Thank you. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you for life. We want to thank you for our heart. We want to thank you for our body that you've just designed it so well. And help us, Father, to look after this machine really well. Help us to be mindful that it is actually a gift from you. And help us, Father, to be able to also, as we live our life, in a way that is pleasing in your sight, that others will also be motivated to also live it in a way that you want them to live. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.